But our government has maintained it didn't want her name made public, and the Prime Minister refused to comment on the case today. I spoke to Lance Burdett, a former police hostage negotiator, earlier this evening. More recently, he's worked with the FBI and MFAT on their policy for negotiations. So I began by asking him, did he think the Red Cross was right to release her name today?
It's one of those things where you're stuck between a rock and a hard place. So it's been 5 years now. If you keep doing the same thing and expecting a different result, then sometimes it's not the right thing. So trying something new could well be the leverage they need.
What seems unusual, though, is the government was saying, look, we don't want her name released. Mm. Does that seem odd to you? What's the usual procedure?
So the usual procedure is to keep it quiet. What kidnappers do is they want media attention. And so by keeping it out of the spotlight, that's the right thing to do.
I mean, that's what the media, including One News TVNZ, signed up for. Right. Why change now, do you think?
I think just to see if there is a shift, to see if people have seen her, to try and get the change in the way things are going. If it hasn't worked in 5 years, then you've got to do something different.
You've been part of negotiations, part of the backroom dealings with this. When someone is kidnapped, what usually happens? Can you walk us through that process?
Sure. Well, the definition of somebody's been kidnapped, they've been taken, they're a hostage now. So she's a hostage because they've asked for something, a ransom, so that's a leverage, so she's a hostage. In those situations, a ransom is never paid, and simply because war, it would happen, you know, time and time again. So the negotiation is done just to wear down the people and to try and keep her as safe as possible. So whoever's been taken, wear them down as best as possible. The intelligence agencies and probably even the military have been working on this as well to try and find out the location to see if there is the opportunity, I guess, to free her. So, yeah, they're working in the background. We'll be using the Five Eyes. We'd be naive to think that the Five Eyes weren't involved in this. So intelligence sources from around the world, particularly the Five Eyes, would have been alerted, and will be doing the best they can to identify where she is.
Were the authorities right not to hand over a ransom and not to negotiate with the terrorists?
Yeah.
Other countries do it.
Other countries do it, and what we find there is that it happens more frequently. A lot of private companies will pay out the ransom because they've got high insurance, you know, they've got insurance premiums to do that, and they get the person back. But not always do they come back. So every time you make contact with the hostage takers, you're asking for a different proof of life question every time to make sure they are still alive. And provide they are still alive, you just keep the negotiation going. It's a real knife-edge game. How far do I push that person?
Doesn't this put New Zealand, though, in the spotlight, the fact that she's been named and the fact that she's from here?
Yes, it does, and that would have been a decision that would have been not taken lightly. So Red Cross are well-versed at working in high-risk situations, and that, dare I say, this has probably happened before. They would have expertise internationally. They wouldn't be dealing it at low level. So it's a decision that's been made, and they would have thought through the consequences.
5 years on, people would say, look, why don't they just send people in and get her out? It's not that simple, though, is it?
No. I mean, you try and find somebody in New Zealand, you try and find somebody in a war zone, even worse. My hope is that something such as Stockholm Syndrome has taken over. So we know that she was nursing, and if she was nursing for ISIS, there would be a trust formed, and hopefully that's what's kept her alive.